Okay, guys, welcome back. Here we are for music, continuing with the Baroque. And I think you guys put in some really great questions about the Baroque opera, and it was fantastic to see. So here today, we're going to be a bit of a longer lecture and an embedded video here. Actually, two videos, and we're going to be looking at instrumental music. We've looked at vocal music. So we looked at Orfeo, the opera, from who? Yes, Monteverdi. And also, we looked at the coffee cantata by our man, Johann Sebastian Bach, okay, from Leipzig, Germany. So we're going to continue today looking at some things that would have been familiar to those composers in their time, in their lives. So still the Baroque, remember, 1600 to 1750 or so. 1750 is the death of Johann Sebastian Bach. So we kind of say, okay, Baroque is done. Bach is done. Baroque is done. Remember, Baroque refers to an architectural style that is not simple, but very, very complex and ornate. So here we go, instrumental music. The symphony that we know today does not exist in the Baroque era, okay? The four-movement symphony, this is not happening. The orchestra is beginning to take its form, though, that we still know today. So you can see here listed, there's some common instruments in the Baroque orchestra. So, you know, violins, violas, cellos, second violins, and that's just the same instrument, but they play in a different part, the double bass. Okay, now we're going to look at a few things also. Bassoons, right? Flutes. We see flutes today made of metal and other things. The wooden flutes would have been used in the Baroque, and also sometimes even ivory flutes, which were quite ornate. We do see some percussion in the timpani or the kettle drum, but most importantly, what's going to set us apart in this Baroque instrumental music is something called the continuo. Right here, the continuo, okay, the continuo, and that's going to be played on a harpsichord or an organ like you see in church. Now, what's a harpsichord? Well, I think that's a great question, and we're going to see a harpsichord in our videos today that we watch. But the harpsichord, gentlemen, unlike a piano, if you understand, pianos have strings and a hammer strikes the string, and that's what makes the sound in the piano. A harpsichord, the strings are actually plucked, and that's what gives it that more plucky sound than a harpsichord. So that's one of the main differences. Now, there's other differences, but what I want you to know, sonically or aurally, that's what is going to set the harpsichord apart. Because also, at this time, the piano has not been invented yet. Right? We in the almost towards the end of the Baroque, do we see the forte piano being invented by an Italian, Cristofori? And actually, here in town, once this is all over, if you go to the Metropolitan Museum of Art and their music instrument collection, they have a piano made in the 1731 or 1732 by Cristofori, and it's the oldest existing piano on earth. So I think that's pretty great, but we can see the layout of the orchestra. It's also not going to be as big. I forgot to mention trumpets, natural trumpets. We see trumpets with valves that we press down. These natural trumpets do not have valves. We're not going to get into why that is today, but to be honest with you, that system was not invented yet. So instruments are not the way we see them today. Instruments change over time, and we know that. So we're going to look at two styles of instrumental music today. We're going to look at the concerto grosso and the orchestral suite. So the concerto grosso, it's going to use a reduced number of players in the orchestra and a soloist. Soloist, someone standing in front. In our case, we're going to see a violin player, and it's really, really great. So smaller numbers in the orchestra plus a soloist. There is no conductor. The person leading the ensemble is here at the front on the harpsichord playing what part again? The continuo, the continuo. This is the harmony, the underlying parts underneath the melody. What gives melody harmony and movement is the continuo. So we see the orchestra being led here from the harpsichord. Note the melody shifts between soloist and small groups of musicians. So the soloist will play something, and then all the orchestra musicians will play, and then it goes back and forth like that, okay? So we're also going to see the concerto grosso in three movements. Those three movements are going to be fast, slow, and fast, okay? So this is typical. This is not every single concerto grosso, but typically, so at least 51%, we're going to see that. This style of music is really popular with composers in Europe. Arcangelo Corelli, an Italian. Antonio Vivaldi, an Italian. And of course, our man, Johann Sebastian Bach. And if they're not included in the video, but his Brandenburg concertos, all five of them, are fantastic pieces of music, and I really suggest listening to the Brandenburg concertos since you guys do have the time at home. We're going to look at Vivaldi, his fourth concerto, the first movement, and it's just the Four Seasons. But quickly, a few things about Vivaldi. I don't think I have him on the next slide, though. Vivaldi is very much a contemporary. He's a Baroque contemporary, so he's alive at these times, and he's Venetian. He lives in Venice. He had many jobs in his life, but often people say, oh, Vivaldi was the Kapellmeister or the kind of the violin teacher or orchestra director at a home for orphaned or abandoned children, predominantly girls, but not 100% in Venice. And he held that position twice in his life. And spent a lot of time. And so a lot of his sacred music, remember sacred is the church, a lot of that music is actually was written at the time when he was working in these two different shifts at this orphanage for abandoned and orphan children. And so his orchestra, on some occasions, because he was teaching them music, were the children of this orphanage. And I think that's really something. So guys, I want you to think about that. You know, kids your age or a little bit younger would be playing some of this music we're going to hear today. And why? Because they weren't up until midnight like you guys doing PlayStation and then homework until 3 o'clock in the morning. And don't think for a second that I don't see when your assignments are getting turned into me. Okay? So I'm going to minimize my video panel here real quick, and we're going to see a little bloop and hide the video panel, because we're going to go ahead and start the concerto number 4. And there might be an ad. We'll see.
One of the great challenges in this world is knowing enough about a subject to think you're right, but not enough about the subject.
So quickly, I want to pull out to you a few things before the video starts here. Here is a keyboard. No, this is not a harpsichord. This is a piano. This is Anna-Sophie Mutzer, a fantastic violin player, and we're going to see. But you do see in here, right here, this guy. Let me see if I can pull up the annotation tool. And let's see the spotlight. Yes. So we can see this guy right here is playing, in fact, the harpsichord. So we'll watch and we'll see this video. And here, this is a harpsichord, guys. Quickly, isn't she great? So remember, we see the soloist followed by the orchestra. The two trade these melodies. You can kind of hear this tension is building. We got a little quiet now with more tension because we know something big's gonna happen. So great. So let's go ahead and close this and come back to our video. And I'm going to go ahead and show the video panel so I can see myself again. And that's great. So that is a piece again by Antonio Vivaldi here, Winter of Movement 1 from the Four Seasons Concerto. So I think that's just really great. I'm not sure why. Let's make sure we're here in full screen. Ah, okay. Very good. Now, moving right along, as we see again, here's our Baroque orchestra. As we see the music still evolving, let's listen to this now by Bach, Johann Sebastian Bach. We're not going to listen to the whole piece. We start seeing, as we get closer, moving into the future, things starting to even further resemble the symphony. This is called an orchestral suite. Now, this is a suite, which means it's different parts, different little parts within the entire work. And as you can see here, there's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 movements. We're not going to listen to all 7 in the orchestral suite, but they are different dance styles. Just like we have different dance styles today, salsa, hip hop, you know, merengue, whatever, breakdancing. We see then, back then, the, you know, we don't see a prelude, but the allemande, the courante, the sarabande, the air, the minuet, and the gigue. Okay, these are just all popular dances, just popular dance styles. That's all they are. So we're going to take a look at just a little bit of the orchestral suite here by our man, Johann Sebastian Bach. Let's bring back the YouTube again, guys. Already, what's the note? What do we notice here? Well, what we notice is that there's a conductor. So this is a modern interpretation of an orchestral suite. We don't see him leading from the harpsichord with the continuo. This is a modern interpretation. Here we see the kettle drums. There's just a harpsichord, guys. Harpsichord again. You can really see the harpsichord. And if I bring up my annotation tools here, if I draw a spotlight, we can see, actually, let's use this tool. You can see here's the harpsichord, the strings on the harpsichord, the different keys on the harpsichord. This is not a piano. This is a one manual, which means one keyboard harpsichord. And you can hear that pluck, pluck, plucking sound. Okay, so I'm going to close the annotation panel and we'll continue with the video. Mm-hmm. repeating there. So that's just the first part of this, but you can go ahead in the notes and look through the orchestral suite. Let's go back to our slides, shall we? And we'll bring up, of course, our video panel so we can see me, and we will go to the full screen. We're coming up on the end, guys. They're doing a great job paying attention. Thank you so much as we're coming into our spring vacation here. So, hey, by the way, people had to make these instruments, right? So let's talk about that for just a moment. And this, I believe, yes, this will be our final slide. So we see here, we often hear about violins, violas, cellos, basses made by a type of an instrument. And people say, oh, the Stradivarius. Well, they're made by this fellow right here, Antonio Stradivari. He's from Cremona, Italy. Look where he lives, 1644 to 1737. So he lives, you know, at the same time. Monteverdi is not alive at this point. I think maybe Monteverdi even dies. Let's see, in the same year, 1643. So the year before Stradivari is born, Monteverdi dies. And he lives until 1737. But of course, we remember our man, Johann Sebastian Bach, 1685 to 1750. We see Bach and Stradivari living together at the same time. So he's from Cremona, Italy, which is a center of places where people make instruments even today. And they're really good violins that are being made still in Cremona. The bridge for my banjo was made by a man who trained in Cremona, but now lives in Genoa, Italy. But it's a 300-year-old piece of wood that's the little bridge on my banjo. And when we get to folk song, hopefully we'll be back in school, but if not, we'll show you on the video. But Antonio Stradivari, master luthier, he's an instrument maker. In his life, he made 1,100 instruments or so. 600 are still left today. Stradivari instruments are incredibly valuable. In 2004, a Stradivari violin made in 1721, so now just about 300 years ago, or 299 years ago at this point, sold for $16 million. $16 million. And now is the point where if we were in the classroom, you'd all say, oh, Mr. Postal, I'd never spend that much. Yes, I understand. And you're probably thinking that. But the good news is that I don't have to hear you say that to me. So I will answer your question anyways. What makes these so valuable? There's a lot of things, to be honest with you. First of all, they're old. And they're not being made anymore, right? So there is supply and demand. Musicians want a Stradivari violin. Only the best musicians that tour the world really can afford to buy one of these. Before we shut down, I took the juniors to the New York Philharmonic, and the violin player we saw there had a Stradivari from 1699, I believe, and she paid $3.7 million for it. So why are they valuable? Are they better than modern violins? Maybe, maybe not. Why do you think a bat, baseball bat, used by, say, I don't know, Hank Aaron when he hit his 764th home run would be so valuable? Well, there's one. Who did it belong to? Hank Aaron. Think about that. Think of the record that he set. And yes, Hank Aaron wasn't a cheater, like the current record holders in baseball. Why is a pair of sneakers worn by Michael Jordan for maybe his first NBA championship so valuable? Well, because think about who they belong to. Think about the context in what they were used. How many of them are there out there? One, in the case of the Michael Jordan sneakers. So, and I know a lot of you guys are sneakerheads. That's why I make this analogy. So then I say, okay, so Stradivari, right? He lived a long time ago. He made a really good instruments. Think about all you have to think. And people say, oh, well, this person owned it, and then this great violin player owned it, and then this great violin. So there's the whole line of all the different famous musicians that have owned these over the history, in some cases, the 300 plus year history of these instruments. And that is just one of the reasons why they're so valuable. You can go see them in our very own Metropolitan Museum of Art. And it's really cool to see them. But it's even more cool to go to a concert and hear someone play one of these instruments. The joy that's so nice to hear these instruments being played and not to see them behind glass, but to hear them and see them being used for what they were meant for. And so those are just a few reasons why the Stradivari violins are worth so much. There were certainly other makers of instruments in Cremona and, you know, Guarini, Amati, these people, and their instruments are also quite valuable as well. So we just know that they were made a long time ago. All the people that have owned them, you can't just go find one. You have to have a lot of money. So this is just some of the reasons why these instruments are so valuable. Let's go ahead and take a look at the final video for this today. And I need to click on this, and then we'll hit maximize one more time. And we're going to go to our video. And this is just a fun video. It's only 5 minutes. I'm going to minimize myself here. And let's see, let's hide the media controls. And so let's go ahead and go full screen. And let's find out, gentlemen, why these instruments are just so valuable. Here we go.
Flying back to New York from a concert in Dallas, he took a taxi from the Newark airport to Manhattan. And before he could take his violin out, the car pulled away.
It was probably the scariest and most devastating experience of my life.
The cab driver returned the instrument a few hours later, but the incident scarred Philippe for good reason. This wasn't just any violin he left in the cab. This was a Stradivarius violin worth over $4 million that's on loan to him.
It's like losing part of yourself, you know, it's like somebody cut off your hand. And especially given the fact it's not your hand. This hand already was belonging to someone else.
Even if you're not a musician like me, you've probably still heard of a Stradivarius violin.
Stradivarius.
Stradivarius.
A Stradivarius?
I mean an original Stradivarius.
They're some of the most famous string instruments in the world, and some of the most renowned musicians have declared their love for them.
This instrument has a soul and it has an imagination.
It's not a tool. It is a part, it's a total extension of me.
Strads, as they're sometimes called, are incredibly valuable and can be worth up to $16 million. But are they actually worth it? I headed up to Lincoln Center to meet Michelle Kim to find out.
I am the assistant concertmaster of the New York Philharmonic.
The characteristic of a Strad in general is that it has a silvery tone, and it creates this incredibly sweet tone. So if you were... For me, the Strad has a sweet quality to it, but also able to take some blows. So if I were to play something really hard, and versus, you know, something. If I played on my daughter's instrument, I would have to press kind of hard to make that sound come out, but you would lose the quality that you're actually looking for.
The source of a Strad's brilliant sound can be traced back to its maker. Artisan Antonio Stradivari was a luthier, or violin maker, who lived in Cremona, Italy in the late 17th and early 18th centuries. He crafted these string instruments for most of his life and produced an estimated 1,100 instruments in his lifetime. But only about 650 survive today. These instruments are rare, and there's a long tradition of nicknaming them. The 310-year-old violin that Philippe plays is called Ruby.
I have to admit, I'm a little bit nervous to be around that.
Okay.
Oh my God, please don't do that.
I Googled the gemstone, the ruby, and the description, I think, was that it's a stone of passion and mystery. And immediately I attributed these qualities to this violin, and to this day, I really feel that it's true.
For generations, musicians have claimed that Strads have a superior sound to modern violins. But can most people actually tell the difference? Researchers in Paris performed a double-blind study with professional violinists to see if they could tell the difference between old Italian violins like Strads and new violins. They had musicians wear very cool sunglasses while they played multiple instruments from each era. The study found that even elite musicians couldn't reliably tell which violins were old and which were new. And maybe more surprisingly, most of them actually preferred the sound of the new violins over the Strads.
One measure of importance is how much influence a maker's had, and no one's had more influence than Stradivari.
This is Joseph Curtin, one of the researchers behind the study and a violin maker himself.
So the question is there some lost secret that something that he knew how to do that no one ever been able to figure out in order to explain some mysterious quality to his sound? And I think the answer is no.
But maybe the worth of a Strad isn't wrapped up in its sound alone. Michel's violin has been passed down through generations of violinists for almost 300 years, from the Duke of Cambridge to the German composer Louis Spohr to Yureli Corelli, the founder of the New York Philharmonic. It is literally a link to the past.
It is a piece of history that you are holding. I feel like this violin is the New York Philharmonic because it has existed as long as the New York Philharmonic has.
It's been amazing to be a part of this Strad's life.
Okay, guys, fantastic. So let's go back to our slides just one more time and then we'll call it good. You've done a great job listening through this lecture, and yeah, it's great. So let me pull up my video panel and we're going to go back to my slides. And here will be the last few things I will say. Let's go back to present. So this is a super brief overview of Baroque instrumental music. There's no way I could do it in one lecture, but hopefully we've seen and heard a bit of it and we've seen some instruments. So now let's talk about your assignment. Okay, I have two questions for you. And in your own words, based on my lectures, what is the difference between a concerto grosso and an orchestral suite? How are they similar? How are they different? Don't go to Wikipedia and look, because I'll know immediately. I want your own words. Listen again. How do they sound different? How are they similar? So please tell me the similarities and differences between the concerto grosso and the orchestral suite. And finally, what makes a Stradivarius violin so valuable? Okay, this will be due on Wednesday at 9 a.m. On Wednesday, we're going to have a short quiz on Baroque instrument, well, the Baroque music. So that'll be Orfeo, that will be the coffee cantata, that will encompass this music here. So review the slides, review the lectures. I'll ask you about composers. I'll ask you about instrument makers. We won't have a listening because I can't figure that out on Classroom, but we'll have a short little 10 question, maybe 15 question, multiple choice quiz that'll spit a grade back at you based on these lectures. So guys, please keep up the good work, and we will see you very, very soon. Okay. Good luck, guys. Bye-bye.